Ruge, help us and our viewers specifically make sense of this this scenario that has emerged recently. President Duterte accepting the nomination for Vice President, Sara issuing a statement saying that she would no longer seek any national position because supposedly she and her father had agreed that only Juan Duterte should run for any national position. But in the meantime, the nominated standard bearer of the PDP Laban Scutsi faction, Senator Bongo, had repeatedly claimed that he was not interested in the presidency. Help us make sense of this.
Christian, I wish I can, but this is uncharted terrain in Philippine political history. Never has especially for the top two posts. We've seen it locally. So you may remember the Binays in Makati as well as other local dynasties, but not the top position. So all of these, in the ideal political world, all of these should be behind the scenes. But as a trademark of this administration, everything is blasted through the visual, through a megaphone, through all these optics. And while it's able to show an image of chaos, of uncertainty, that further adds to the uncertainty that we are all experiencing right now, given the pandemic, it also allows the administration and the Dutertes to continue to captivate the public. It's like we're all waiting to exhale on. It seems like we're following, as what Dr. Contreras said, a telenovela, and the plot is unknown, and there's developments every day. So from the very cold balance sheet of political science, it's quite mind-boggling. But hey, this is Philippine politics style, that all is in the family, and that the power of an incumbent president still looms large, even if that president is already on his way out of his tenure.
Okay. As he was a disruptor in 2016, he continues to try to disrupt the way politics is run, for better or for worse, going into 2022.
He is actually a troll. He's trolling us. He's trolling everyone. And he's also trolling the political science as a discipline. You know, it's basically like showing us that we need to like recalculate, recalibrate, look at our books and our theories, what does apply and what does not apply. And I think the thing about what, however, there are certain tropes, there are certain narratives that are becoming more predictable. That, you know, that is common in the Duterte dynasty, I would say. It's that issue of having a show of not being interested, and then in the end they change their mind. You know,
you saw that in 2015.
Yeah, so it's something that it is, and Bongo is part of that dynasty, so probably it's already has been infected by that kind of predisposition.
Okay.
Yung hele hele bago kere, you know. Of course, they can surprise us by giving truth. Talagang hindi pala tatakbo si Sara, hindi pala tatakbo si Bongo. You know, they can always do that, which is for some people would be good, a good alternative. But you know, some, it will now no longer be surprised kung tatakbo talaga yung mga yan. Magbabago sila ng isip.
Okay, Professor Arugay, and of course, Professor Contreras can also add to this. Do you think the conflict between father and daughter is actually real at this stage, at this level of politics? Because there are others who might be thinking that perhaps Duterte, the father, and Bongo are just setting the stage for the proper re-emergence of the daughter as someone who's independent, someone who could not be controlled by the father, and that eventually Bongo and Duterte would actually pave the way and give way for the daughter to run eventually. I mean,
Christian, it's going to be a very complicated, calculated path to maneuver, because I don't think if Sara Duterte runs for president that she can really be independent, seen as independent. She is her father's daughter, and you can see the personality being genetically being seen also from the daughter. She put her foot down that she will not respect nor support PDP Laban, that she will not. That is the statement being issued right now. But we also see that whatever happens, if Sarah runs, she will have to defend the record of the administration in order to get the vote base of his of the supporters of the president. But I think what is happening here is that if there is some distancing, it's this very careful, she's like walking on a tightrope, making sure that what she would do is to she would be the better version of fulfilling whatever vision the Duterte would had promised. And I don't know about the argument for continuity, but if she will make that move, the strategic move to be independent, the only way to be able to keep the base and maybe convert some of the independent or fence sitter voters is to say that I'm an enhanced and improved version, that I am Duterte 2.0, that I don't have the negotiated parts of Duterte that some of the Filipino public would not want to really delve at, but I have some of his traits. I will continue his vision, but I will do it in a different way that will not have more collateral damage than what is or has been accepted by the Filipino public for the past 5 years.
Okay, well, Professor Estrada.
From what I know, is that indeed, you know, in their private lives, because I have, you know, from reliable sources, which I could not name, that there have been episodes where Sarah and the father had falling out. They differ on many issues. And then you have to also count Bongo in the entire picture. It's not just a relationship between Sarah and the father. It's also a relationship between Sarah and Bongo, and Bongo and the father. So maybe the father-son relationship is mediated by the kind of relationship that Sarah has with Bong. So that might be something that we need to factor in. Kasi kung hindi sila magkasundo, yan dalawang yan, factor yan. Okay? Kasi it could be possible because it's a family. And there could be certain issues where you disagree with the person whom your father trusts. Mm-hmm. So that will definitely affect. And sometimes if your father believes that person, then you would have some strained relationship. So that's a possibility. So and that is why the move of Bongo not to accept the nomination would be an indication of what could come out from this. So if Bongo runs, then that could also be another factor to consider. But I agree with Aris that, you know, Sarah would attempt to be distance herself from the father, to establish some kind of, you know, a base that whatever I'm just the improvement of the better Duterte, he has his flaws and I'm not that. So if you don't like him because of his flaws, but you still want the best in him, then that's me. She can have that. Yung pangit sa kanya, wala ako niyan, pero yung maganda sa kanya, dahil anak niya ako, kaapelido, meron ako niyan. So pwede, she can spin that and play on that narrative. Now as to how many people can be enamored or can be attracted or can be beguiled by that kind of play, we don't know. Okay. Will it stick? Will it even, how many, baka ma-convince niya dyan, yung mga talagang matagal nang convince na rin na will it change independent-minded people? Okay. Kasi yun, I think that is a factor, Christian, that will shape the outcome of the elections. How many are still undecided? How many have not committed yet to a particular candidate? How many people can still change their minds? There are many people who is running, like, batting for Lenny Robredo. But if Lenny doesn't run and decide to run for governor in Camarines Sur, sinong magbe-benefit niya na butante? Kaya sa mga surveys, dapat importante sino ang second choice. And that is why in our survey, we are now asking people a question that is rarely asked, which is basically, who is your second choice? And you're going to change your mind. Kasi we don't see that in surveys. And then we also have asked our respondents, who among the candidates you will never vote for? Hindi rin natin alam eh, kasi dapat tingnan mo rin yung kahit pa mangyari ito, hindi ko iboboto yung kandidatong yan. Hindi natin yan nalalaman sa mga current surveys sa ngayon. Okay. And so doon sa amin sa DigiVoice, malalaman namin yan. In fact, we okay. already have the data.
Okay.
So hindi ko lang, I'm not yet at liberty, hindi wala lang ako sa liberty sabihin kasi hindi pa siya processed.
Okay. Professor Arugay, what do you think of this Ping Lacson and Tito Soto candidacy? Launched formally, at least a declaration, on the same day that the National Convention by PDP Laban was held. It gives you a sense that somehow they're also trying to present themselves as some sort of an improvement to what's good with Duterte, right? I don't know if you agree with that. Pero I don't know if you also noticed the optics, diba? The shirt, the plaid shirts that they wore. Somehow that could give you an idea that somehow they were trying to also benefit from whatever good image Duterte still has, no? Pero are they... And specifically, Senator Lacson, can he be considered as a viable alternative as he likes to present himself now?
Right. I think what the message of the Lacson-Soto tandem, the message that they're trying to get across to the Filipino public is that we have many overlaps with the issues that we want to be addressed by in the country today. So it's still the same laundry list as the Duterte administration and even the Duterte presidency. It's still crime, drugs. The basic change is that there's a pandemic, but I think they're trying to also court some of the perhaps disaffected voters or disaffected supporters, but still want some major improvements on issues on peace and order and security. They try to heavily criticize the administration and say that we're the better drivers of this car, if the car is the country. But we will drive the same way as the administration. We won't just be as rowdy as the previous administration. But I think if we have a deeper dive in their recent history and track records, you could really show that they were allies. They were part. Senator okay. Soto remained Senate President. Senator Lacson authored the Anti-Terrorism Act. So all these are very important. If voters simply delve into their histories, it would show that their ability to distance might not be as effective, given how close they are. And how they have refrained from joining any efforts of the opposition to come up with a single candidate.
Precisely. Don't you think it would be much easier to destroy that emerging campaign narrative from the Lacson-Soto tandem? I'd like to use that metaphor. No? The Duterte is the driver, is the one driving the car, but they were in the back seat. They were also tapping the shoulder of the driver for the longest time and telling him, "Well, you're doing a good job."
Yeah.
Hey, Professor Contreras.
Yeah, Christian, you know, the thing about the Lacson-Soto tandem is that they're not hurting the Duterte camp or the Duterte base. Because technically, the Duterte base is a solid base that looks at anyone who fights the Dutertes as an enemy, even if you were a previous former friend. You know, that's how they see people. They see people on a black and white. If you are not with us, you're against us. And so they're going to... So what happens is that the Lacson-Soto tandem will erode further the base of the opposition because it will appeal to independent voters. It will probably a little bit of the dissatisfied Duterte supporters, but I don't know how many is that, you know. So they are bad news more to the likes of Lenny Robredo, the likes of Isko Moreno, because makakabawa sila doon sa pay, sa bibingka. Samantalang, they will never take away votes from the loyalist base of either Duterte or Marcos. So whether it will help the agenda of providing an alternative to the Duterte base is for me a bit shaky. Okay. It's something that they're and I think the only way the opposition can win over a possible Duterte Marcos alliance is for them to unify. Otherwise, the more people will run, the more is the probability that, you know, we are going to have another 6 more years of either a Duterte daughter or a Duterte father being a vice president or a Bongo, whatever the combinations. Okay. And I tell you, you know, the only way that the administration, the Duterte Marcos alliance can crack is if Marcos will run and a Duterte will run, because that will also break that solid base. So It's really a game right now. You know, it's a game of thrones in a way. Who's going to give up? But what is certain is this: if in order to have a good fighting chance, there should be fewer candidates. Period. There should be fewer candidates in this. The more candidates there will be, it will be good for the administration.
Okay. Finally, Professor Aruga, I'd like to get your thoughts regarding the initial lineup of senators by the PDP Laban Party. Of course, historically, the incumbent or the administration ticket doesn't always come up with the best choices during the next presidential election. But in this case, what do you make of this? Is this the best lineup that they could come up with at this stage?
Well, Dr. Condre, I share the laughter of Dr. Contreras,
but I laugh at the word best to offer.
But I think what they're coming from is they're still punch drunk from the victory in 2019, which I think is way, way long time ago. Meaning it's a different terrain. There are a lot of returning senatorial candidates who seem to have saved or some form of a birthright in the Senate. A lot of these old guard will want to have their seats back, and it will be a very tight or there's so many spots. There's too little spots, and there's so many political ambitions. And they're all banking on being having a residue of the Duterte magic, which was very potent in 2019. But given the pandemic response, given how our economy is faring, given all these corruption allegations, it's totally a different political landscape. And if I'm part of the administration list right now for the Senate, then I should have more tools in my toolkit apart from my hand being raised by Duterte campaign time.
Okay, Professor Aris Aruga and Professor Antonio Contreras, thank you, gentlemen, for joining us tonight.
Thank you
for having us.
Okay. We're going to take a quick break. After the fact, we'll be right back.